You know, you put range balls out there and give somebody a club, and they're ready to play, even though it's raining here. And you could have stayed out there for a little while, right?
Longer than I thought. I thought it was going to be two or three balls, and then you get hooked. Right? You guys got the target out there.
Yeah, I know.
Everyone's trying to make a hole-in-one.
But are you competitive at everything?
Even sleeping. No. Yeah, pretty much, I guess, in some way.
I mean, you're wired that way?
Somewhat wired that way. I mean, I had an older brother who just beat me up and told me I couldn't beat him at anything. So,
you got revenge in a variety of ways?
Well,
we
competed at just everything when we were kids, so it was kind of a natural thing. And some of it was fun, and some of it was kind of serious. But you know, it was able to be applied to my sport, obviously.
Full intro here: Kelly Slater, 55 career wins, crowned World Surf League champion 11 times, including 5 consecutive titles, 94 to 98, playing in the AT&T Pebble Beach Pro-Am. What's the best weather to surf in?
You just don't want too strong a wind, really. The rain doesn't matter. Cold doesn't matter.
What about waves?
It just depends on what you like. I mean, for a beginner, obviously something small, like as big as a table here, but... you know, I got friends that chase 60, 80-foot waves. In fact, the waves in Portugal, I think, today are really giant, at that Nazaré wave. So I would expect to see waves of probably 70, 80 feet this afternoon.
Have you surfed in this area?
I have a little bit. There's some good little waves around here. A lot of guys surf right off Spanish Bay there.
Maverick?
I surf Mavericks a couple times. I've actually only ever surfed it 3 times. People are like, how do you like Mavericks? Like, have you surfed it? I go, yeah, I've surfed it 3 times, and I almost drowned twice.
But what is that feeling like? Like almost drowning?
Well, I don't know how close I was, but yeah, it's, I don't know. I think it's super scary until it's like a euphoric feeling. You don't remember anything because you probably pass out.
What's the strategy when you're being held under?
Relax as much as possible. You know, the whole thing with being able to hold your breath a long time is keeping your heartbeat down, keeping your adrenaline down. You want to be like calm. You think surfing is kind of an adrenaline sport, but it's really, especially in big waves, about being calm and being relaxed and being comfortable and not letting the fear take over and control what you're doing. So
how long can you hold your breath for?
I don't know, probably close to 5 minutes, 4.5 minutes or something.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, try it right now. It won't be a great interview, but it'll be cool to watch this on TV.
Yeah. I will mime through this.
Oh, I
It'll
like
be
that.
Great.
When did you know that this was your calling?
Pretty early on, not necessarily as a profession, but by the time I was probably 7 or 8. And when I was 8, I first started competing, but prior to that, I already felt like surfing was going to be my life in some way. It was just something we did every day. It wasn't really a career path back then. I think the first world champion in 76 or 77, a guy named Peter Townend, I think he won about $2,000 that year. I'm not exaggerating. And The entire year, yeah.
And he was the best.
He was the world champ at the end of the year. And, you know, before 1980, I don't think anyone made more than maybe $4,000 in a year competitively. So when I was a kid, it wasn't like, I'm going to grow up and be a pro surfer. That really was more of a lifestyle thing. It wasn't like a career path, you know.
But when you say to your family, I want to be a pro surfer.
It was such a natural part of our life that you know, it was just, it wasn't, I don't know, there was never any pushback against it. You know, my parents were super supportive of everything we did.
What do you put down on your tax return? What do you do for a living?
Human.
That's,
you know,
it.
I put pro surfer and I'm like, that's so weird. I don't know. Every time I write that, all I can think of is Tony Hawk's book. Tony Hawk Pro Skater, and that was because it was, you know, what he always put when he came through immigration. So.
But you two were similar, I think, in bringing your sport into the limelight, sponsorship. Is there parallels with you and Tony Hawk?
I guess there's some parallels in that we both had a longevity to our career and sort of competitively been at the top for a long time. And but you know, Tony, as far as action sports, Tony was a guy who put, I would say, all of us really, truly on the map with Tony Hawk Pro Skater. And, you know, his video games became such a household item for people. And I don't know if that was true or not, but I heard a rumor back when that launched and he was just ultra famous that his was the most sought after autograph in the world for some period of time.
Really?
That was what I had heard.
Well, let's just go with it. I mean, it sounds
sounds good. Yeah.
Might let facts
get in. Some credibility. I mean, who wanted Mandela? You know, there was Tony Hawk.
But does being a great surfer translate into other sports? Are you a snowboarder? Like, can you do other things?
I grew up skating, so it was. I'm not a great skater, but I was all right as a kid. And we used to just build little quarter pipes and half pipes around at friends' houses. And snowboarding didn't really start until I was in my teenage years, but it was pretty quick to catch on. I think for most surfers, it's somewhat quick to learn it.
He's Kelly Slater, world champ. Where's all your hardware? Do you get like all your trophies and everything?
It's funny when I was an amateur, I probably won about 200 trophies, and we had them like in a pile behind our house outside, and then we just kind of got tired of looking at them. So I kept the ones that meant a lot to me, like a U.S. championship or an East Coast title, or you know a few of the international ones, and then literally put a pile of like marble and trophies out on the road. And I remember somebody coming collecting a whole bunch of
somebody's
marble.
Got a lot of your trophies.
Well, I think they were just taking the marble and selling it. Or something. Oh, wow. I should have kept it myself.
But. Do you have a favorite surfboard? Like if I go to your house or go to your garage, how many? Let's say you had to take one surfboard out of the garage.
Yeah.
Let's say it's on fire. You got to take one out.
Oh man.
Is there one you take out?
It'd be a handful.
Oh, would be?
You know, a couple under each arm. I have a board when I won my fifth world title that Al Merrick, who is my shaper, and he's kind of like a second father to me. Al made me this this board, a hollow wood board, as a gift. That was in 97. And that's always been like my sort of prized board, I think, in my house. I've ridden it one time. I went out in the middle of winter on the coldest day and caught one wave in a pair of trunks. And I said, okay, I'll never ride that board again. So, but it was just a gift he made for me and a special thing for the house.
You ever get to pants during a ride? Lose your pants?
Short. Oh, a free ride?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Free ball.
I've only free rode at night, actually. One time I was night surfing and did it. I don't know.
Wait, so you don't skinny dip. You surf nude.
I've skinny dipped before.
I know, but this is your version.
Not
skinny
with you.
Dip. No. Yeah. Paulie, do you have video of Kelly?
It's coming up right here.
Yeah. You were actually looking to see if we have video of you naked here.
I was, actually. That would be strange. I mean, who hacked my iCloud?
But you've never had, like, a date where you're surfing at night like that?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Yeah, I thought...
Maybe.
No. Can you stay? Can we take a break? All right.
Hey.
All right. We'll come. By the way, guys, want to know where you
got
the flannel?
Walk of shame here. I'm hanging around.
Yeah, you got the flannel here.
The flannel's big talk this morning. That's
no, it looks good.
Good stuff. Thank you.
Are you wearing that to play in today?
No, I'm not. This is actually my clothing line.
So it looks good.
I got this yesterday, and I was like, I like this. I'm going to wear this today.
Looks good. All right, we'll come back with Kelly Slater right after this. 11 times he's won the World Surf League Championship. Maybe you got one of his trophies if you drove by his house on the side of the road.
You might have.
And 5 consecutive titles, 94 through 98. Where do you get recognized more than other places? Is there one spot in the world where, aside from an event that you're in?
Yeah, Brazil and Australia probably. The most,
but is this like fanboy crazy when they see you on the streets?
It can be, yeah. I mean, especially around events, and you know, if you're in one place for just a week or something, you know, and everyone knows your face, then yeah, it's a little bit hectic.
Strangest reaction you've gotten from a fan?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I can't think of one offhand. I signed a dog once.
A dog?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. No, there's weird ones, though. I had a stalker years ago in France. That was really odd. I mean, literally, like, straight out of, like, some bunny boiling movie. It was, she was, like, sleeping in front of our hotel room and writing all over the walls of the hotel and the elevator in lipstick. It was really scary. It was actually really frightening. And she had a young child, an infant sort of child, maybe. Well, when she started, but a few years later, by the time the kid was about 5, she was still going. It was really scary, though. She would follow me, like, in my car, she'd see me driving and follow me to the airport or like to a restaurant and then stand 2 feet away from me and take pictures of me like nonstop. It was really bizarre.
You never caught a wave and all of a sudden you look down and she's in like snorkel gear or anything like that, right?
Not quite, but she would stand at the water's edge with signs she made and stuff. It was really, really out there.
Did you alert the authorities?
I tried to. One day, I was actually going through a lot of personal stuff at the time, and that was just compounding it. And I went to the airport to try and get a flight out, just kind of a cold call. Just, I'm going to go to the airport and see if there's a flight. And it was kind of this one terminal airport in Biarritz. And she followed me there. And she was walking through the airport. There was no one in the airport except for a security guard and a couple people that worked at the airlines. And she was following me through the airport, taking pictures of me this far away. And holding, she had a sign even there. And she was like really acting starstruck, but crazy at the same time to me. And trying to tell the people there who I was in French and how great she thought I was or something. But it was like psychosis. It wasn't just like, oh, I love what you do. Can you sign this? Great to meet you. This was something otherworldly.
Paulie, let's bring out the stalker. Can you bring her out here? She's here. How much would you charge to teach, let's say, an hour of surfing?
How much you got?
How much do I have, Paulie?
Our guess would be 10 grand an hour. If you
actually, I'm free. I'm cheap.
No, but yeah. If somebody wanted to.
I don't think I would charge anyone to show them how to surf. I don't know.
How long would it take for you to show somebody how to surf?
I'm a soul surfer, man. No.
Oh. Yeah. Oh. Okay.
No.
Could you teach any of these guys how to surf?
Yeah. No, it's easy. You know, to learn how to surf, the problem with people who want to be a good surfer is they want to start on a small little board that they can't work with. So when you start, you just need a big board that looks like a boat, basically. And then you got to get used to paddling and being able to judge waves and obviously start on a small wave and just get your confidence up and learn how to position yourself and paddle for the wave at the right time and that kind of stuff. So you don't want to be worried about like sinking and, you know, the board won't float and that kind of stuff.
Are you retired?
No.
Retiring?
Are you?
No.
Oh.
No.
Yeah. No, so, I'm full time still.
You are?
Yeah.
And how much longer? But it feels like the last couple of years, it feels like there's been rumors that you're retiring.
Yeah, there's been rumors. I've been retiring since 98.
But why do they... It's weird how people... You get to a certain point. Like Tom Brady, well, is he going to retire? You know, Peyton Manning, is he going to retire? You get to a certain point, and then people say, hey, you're going to retire.
That's because that's what's happened, I think, in the past with people. When I got on tour, I'm turning 45 tomorrow. When I got on tour, the oldest guy on tour was 28 or 29. Wow. So it kind of gives a little perspective. But that also has to do with... you know, my sport was young and guys weren't really taking care of themselves. They were having a good time though, but they weren't really taking the sport seriously, like longevity, longevity wise.
45.
Yeah. So, you know, guys were kind of partying and having fun, living it up. You know, you get to travel around the world and get paid. It's pretty fun.
Did you have that stretch where you had fun, partied?
A couple weeks.
Though that's
no, no, I mean, yeah, I had fun. I've had fun here and there, but I was so focused on,
I mean, your Baywatch days. Come on.
Yeah, man, I was partying.
Where?
No, no.
You weren't?
No, I never really got into that phase. I mean, here and there, a few drinks here and there, that's kind of thing for me. I've never been, I was so focused on competition and winning, achieving goals and stuff that wasn't part of my deal.
Ever have a surfing hangover? Gone on the board when you got a hangover?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, that's horrible. I've actually, you know, in the old school days, like all the guys that were my heroes, not all of them, but yeah, pretty much all of them, I'd see them sometimes at contests, like they didn't sleep the night before and they go straight out and surf a heat kind of thing, you know. I saw that a lot of times when I first got on tour. This is like, you know, around 1990 time, and I mean, you know, guys are young, having fun, traveling around, making pretty good money and not really any obligation to anything. So
what about trying to explain your sport or what you've accomplished? It feels like it's a moving target where somebody's trying to understand how great you are with your sport, where we can say Tiger with golf or Tom Brady with football or Michael Jordan with basketball. You're the most decorated surfer in history. But do people understand, or how do we categorize that greatness?
I don't know. That sort of feels like a conversation I shouldn't be a part of.
I know you're being humble, but just trying, because when I say, the first time you were on, you know, I think people said, oh, he's the Michael Jordan of surfing. Mm. Are you? But, I mean, is that, or are you just Kelly Slater of surfing?
I don't know how to answer these questions, Dan, to be honest with you.
Yeah. But
my mom just beat it into me as a kid. Don't talk about yourself, you know? Like, don't talk about yourself like that.
Because I remember you came on, and I talked about you're one of the great athletes that we have.
Thank you.
And then people don't understand. Okay, well, how do you explain surfing? And judging it, and it's open to interpretation.
It is. It's every sport. I mean, how do you judge not only sport to sport, but also generation to generation? Yeah. How do you compare Ali to Tyson?
Yeah.
You know, how do you compare different guys at different times? You know, can you say Tiger Woods and Jack Nicklaus, one's better than the other? They never really went head-to-head, so you don't see, and it was a different type of game and equipment, and, you know, things evolve and change. You know, tennis went from kind of a feel sport to a power sport. There's so many different ways to play and do things, and then try to not only generation to generation, but sport to sport.
What's
tougher? You know, some are just like, you know, football, you just hammer somebody and, you know, or you're a great passer or whatever. But just in football, how many different skills are there? You know, there's a lot of different skill sets. You know, one guy's not doing everything. So it's guys are good. Guys become great or proficient. I think the greats in sport are good at most aspects of what they do. Like, they're at the top echelon of each of the different skills. And you kind of have to be to win for a long period of time, I think.
Tougher, surfing or golf?
Gosh, I mean, golf seems so easy sometimes, and then it gets cold and rainy at Pebble, and you feel like an idiot.
Did you feel like an idiot
yesterday?
Well,
I went out 2 days ago at Cypress and shot 74, and I went out yesterday, and I think I shot 90 or more at Monterey Peninsula. It was just, I just wasn't feeling it. It was just, like I said, we started off first hole, three out of the four of us put it in the bushes on the first hole. We started with a double bogey for the team, and I was saying I haven't done that in like 12 years of playing Pebble Beach Pro-Am. I don't think we've had one double bogey ever in the whole time. So it was a tough day.
But you had one of those moments where you get on the board and you know you don't have it? Like you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I definitely have mornings I'll wake up and I'm like, I don't feel it. And I mean, I've even literally gone home, showered again, eat again, start my whole day over. Like, I just, it's not not feeling right, you know? You got to brush it off, almost lay back in the bed for 5 minutes, go, okay, let's start this again, you know? But that's life, you know? It's not just sport. That's just life. Everyone has bad days, so.
We appreciate you stopping by. Who do you get mistaken for? Does anybody say, aren't you? You ever get that?
Not really. I've been called Christian Slater many times. Christian Slater.
Really?
Yeah. We look nothing alike. We have one similar name. Dennis Rodman. Dennis Rodman. I swear, every time I see the guy, hey, Christian, what's going on, man? Are you serious? Yeah, man. Who you been hanging out with?
Well, he called me Craig Sager for you. He never knew my name. He'd say, what's up, Sager? And I started answering to him after a while. I mean, I just, like, I'm not even going to try to convince him.
Let's call him and let's call Sager and ask him. Yeah. No, I saw a thing with Dennis Rodman where there's a band called Live, and he had known the lead singer for like 15 years.
Lightning.
And he's calling
crashes.
Him the wrong name. Yeah. And he's calling him the wrong name. And the guy actually called him. And he goes, Dennis, how long have I known you? And he's like, 15 years. And you still call me the wrong name.
Who is that? Ed Kowalski?
I don't even know how to say his last
Kowalski?
Name.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't blame him for not knowing the last name, but the first name's pretty easy.
I could see maybe a younger Michael Stipe.
Michael Stipe?
Hmm? Lead singer REM?
Of course I know who he is.
Yeah. All right. See that. Yeah. All right. Don't embarrass yourself today, all right?
Well, it's all uphill from... It's all downhill from here. Whichever way. It's easier. Today's easier.
Thank you for sending the surfboard that we have in the man cave.
Of course.
And we're all big fans.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me on. Yeah. I mean, it's not often I get to hang out with jocks. It's Pebble Beach, and that's about it, you know?
He's not retiring. He's Kelly Slater. He's got 11 titles. Kelly, great to have you.
Thanks
thank
a lot,
you
guys.
For stopping by.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.